Afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to Find My Past Live. Thank you so much for joining today. My name is Ellie. I run social media for Find My Past. Please drop me a comment so I know that the stream and the sound is working okay, because there might be some gremlins lurking somewhere, and we certainly do not want that. Oh, we've got our first few viewers. Hi, Kim. Hi, William. Fantastic. Good. I hope it's working okay then. So if you are new to our live sessions here on Facebook, we're running a number of events during the week, live events on a variety of different topics. So if you're interested in family history, in learning about your family tree, this is the place to be at the moment. And they involve a number of our in-house experts. Now, I don't class myself as an expert, but I do have help from one today, so don't worry. Now, if you've missed any of these previous discussions, remember you can go back and catch up. If you go to the Find My Past Facebook page and you click video, you can watch them all back there, and you can watch them whenever you want to as well. So that's good. Now, if we have popped up on your news feed and you don't know who we are yet, or maybe you've seen one of our fantastic new TV adverts, because let's be honest, don't they look incredible? I'm really, really happy with them. We are Find My Past. We are a UK-based family history company. We've got a fantastic website, we've got a free tree feature, but we've also got brilliant historical records that you can go into, and you can find your ancestors, and you can find the stories that make up your ancestors' lives. And it is really, it's a passion project for so many of us, myself included. I'm sure many of you in the comments are already so into family history, but just in case you weren't sure who we are, that is who we are. Now, we bring more historical records online every single week, so every Friday. And we've got staff based here in the UK, we've got staff in the US, in Ireland. I'm based up here, up in Scotland. Yeah, if you are new, we are going to be running another session on Tuesday next week. I'm going to be back. I know you might be sick of me by that point. I'm going to be running a sort of guided tour of Find My Past website. I'm going to be sharing the screen, and I'm just going to be talking you through where you can find everything, things I think you might find useful. So be sure to come back next week for that if you are interested. It's going to be 4 o'clock on Tuesday. Brilliant. And I just wanted to say as well, I can't quite put into words how grateful I am for all of you who keep tuning into these. They are for you, but I love our online community, basically. I love our Find My Past forum, and I just love that you help each other out and you support each other, and it makes it's I have the best job in the world, basically, just watching you help each other and talk to each other about our shared love of history of the past. I'm just very happy, basically. I won't gush for any longer than that, I think. But I think we should have a look at who has joined us today, shouldn't we? So I've already said hi to Kim and William. Hello, Linda. Hello, Paul. Hello, Nicole. Hello, Ivy. Got Anthony, Michelle, Debbie, Laurie, Nicola, Debbie. Anya, Julie, Maxine, Kathleen, Sue, Rosie, Colleen from Australia. Goodness, thank you for joining us. Jackie, Michael, Cindy from a gloriously sunny coastal Aberdeenshire. Well, Cindy, I'm going to be honest, I'm here in Fife, and it was a beautiful over lunch and went for a glorious walk, and it's now clouded over. So this is why I've not got sun streaming in through my windows today. Julie in sunny Devon. And Linda, oh, fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us, everybody. I hope you find this session useful. I encourage you all to grab a cup of tea. Okay, I've not got tea in this actually. I've actually got water in this. I'm actually one of these people who doesn't drink tea. Please don't think any less of me because of that. Please don't. Yeah, grab a cup of tea, grab a cup of coffee, plate of biscuits, slice of cake. We're gonna have a nice little relaxed look today at parish registers. And I'm very, very privileged to say we are joined in the comments once more by one of our in-house experts, Steve Rigden. He's kindly provided answers to some of your pre-submitted questions on parish records. So I'm going to be doing my bit and I'm going to be passing along the information to you. And if you have any other questions about parish records, just drop them in the comments and we'll see if we can get to the live questions at the end. Equally, I want to hear if you've had any real good successes from using parish registers. What discoveries have you made if you're already into your family history? So let me know, talk to each other, talk to Steve. We've also got Alex with us. He's just finishing up a little bit of work, I believe, but he will be joining us in a moment. And spoiler alert, he has shaved his beard. I know, he looks so baby-faced now that he's shaved it. It's unbelievable. Karen says also, do not drink tea and neither does William. Good, I'm not alone. Good, fantastic. So what we'll do is we'll crack on and then what we'll do is we'll have a look at some of your questions. So what I wanted to start with is, especially if you're new to family history or maybe you've taken it up after a little bit of a break, you might be wondering, what are parish records and what can they actually do for you? What can you get out of them, I suppose? So for me specifically, you can just go back hundreds of years with them. I mean, I'll go on to the history of them in a moment, but you can go back to the times of the Tudors for some of them, which I just think is incredible. You can find whole families stretching back hundreds of years, great for growing your tree. For baptisms, you can search with the surname and then the first names of both parents, which is really fantastic. So you can find all the children of a particular couple. But do remember to obviously cross-reference into burial records as well, just in case, you know, sadly a child did pass away in infancy. What's quite good about parish records as well, some of them are really detailed, excuse me, very detailed. So some of them even include the father's occupation. So that helps you rule that record in or out as to whether they are your ancestors or not. And some of them also include the address or the abode of the parents. So again, really handy. You can then cross-reference that with census records. So that's always good. So yeah, parish records are incredible and we are adding more all the time. Whenever we get our hands on some new ones, we do add them to Findmypast. So do check back every Friday to see what we've added. But I suppose that leads me nicely on to what parish records actually are. Now I have had some help from Steve on this because he is the expert. But I just wanted to start out, how do they actually stand out from life event records in general? Because if you're a beginner to family history in the UK in particular, or you've just started researching a new ancestor, one of the best places to look for that ancestor is the General Register Office for their index for births, marriages and deaths. So in 1837 in England and Wales, the General Register Office was set up and it became necessary for all of these life events to be registered with the government. This is why nowadays, if you have a child or you get married or somebody passes away, that a certificate is issued, but you've also got the index as well. So that's what we've got on our website. I like to think of it as certificate light, because it's not got quite as much information as a full certificate would. Linda says she's late, she walked too far. Can you walk too far, Linda? I think it's great to be getting out and about nowadays, especially if you've got a beautiful countryside around you or you're near the coast or just anywhere really. So thank you for joining us. Sorry, I'll crack on now. Trying to keep an eye on the comments at the same time, you see. So around this time, so in 1837 and just afterwards, not all of these life events were actually registered with the government, because the information actually only had to be supplied if it was asked for by a registrar. So this is why sometimes you might not find your ancestor in these index records going back to the early days of civil registration. So, but by 1875, the Births and Deaths Act came into force and it became a legal requirement for those present at a life event to report it. So more life events were recorded at this point, and it's much less likely that your ancestor would be missed. So a similar system in Ireland was introduced in, I think, 1845, and then in Scotland in 1855. Brilliant. So why am I telling you this? Because mainly, as great as a starting point these records are for beginners in particular, or for a particular ancestor at the start of when you're researching their life, sometimes you might need to order the full certificate at an extra cost. And these records don't go beyond 1837. And with the first census for England, Scotland and Wales being 1841, that's a big cutoff date for life events and for trying to find your ancestors as a maybe a beginner family historian. So we need something else to check. How do we get further back than 1837? And the answer, as I'm sure you probably already guessed, is with parish records. I'm not very subtle, I'm sorry. So I'm going to come to the questions in a moment, but I'm going to play Professor Ellie for a couple of moments, thanks to Steve as well, because he helped me put this together. So back in 1538, King Henry III famously divorced not only his wife, but he also divorced from the Vatican and the Catholic Church, and he declared himself head of the Church of England. And effectively, this means that churches in England were Roman Catholic before that year, and then they were Anglican afterwards. So many of you, if you've got roots in England and Wales in the 16th century, you'll have Catholic ancestors as well. Many of whom converted to the new religion, I say the new religion, new denomination. And some carried on being Catholics, of course, as well. So most of the population became Anglican rather than Catholic because of the state decree at this point. And as all this was going on, Mr. Thomas Cromwell, he issued a decree requiring the registers of baptisms, marriages and burials. They had to be recorded by the parish. And before this point, Catholic parish priests and religious houses had kept sort of only informal notes, and mainly only on prominent families as well. So by the time 1538 comes around, this is supposedly for everybody. So this is a gold mine for family historians. And if you can get back to 1538, that is brilliant. I'm very, very lucky, actually. One of my lines, my overthrow line, I have got back to that point, and I'm so chuffed. The others have been a little bit more tricky, as I'm sure many of you will sympathize with. So at this point, all the Anglican parish registers in England and Wales, they started out life in a place of worship, so in a church. And at this point as well, they were just sort of scribbled on bits of paper, anything that the incumbent of the parish had lying around in the church. The handwriting might have been difficult to read also. And I don't know about you, but I've come across some in Wales that have been in three different languages. So I've come across an early one that was in English, Welsh and Latin. That was one record, believe it or not. That was interesting to read, especially because my Latin skills are not brilliant, we'll put it that way. So at this point as well, because they would vary from parish to parish, they would also vary in size, vary in detail, and you know, as I said, the incumbent would just use whatever material was on hand that he could use. But by the end of the 16th century, they moved from paper over to parchment. And in some parishes, the priests were even copying the older registers onto parchment, which is great for us, because nowadays they've survived better, shall we say. But again, whoever was recording these details, they were just recording it as they saw fit. And this is why the detail will vary from parish to parish. So one parish incumbent might record just parents' names, maybe even just the father's name, and maybe the name of the parish, the name of the child, if it's a baptism perhaps. Whereas others might go into more detail. So where they lived, the name of the mother as well, the maiden name of the mother, which as we all know, that is gold dust for family historians. Yeah, that's just something to bear in mind for earlier ones. The detail is going to vary massively. But from about 1754, this is when parish registers became better organised. So parishes at this point had printed and bound blank registers, and this could separate out the life events as well, because before this point, the parish priest or the parish incumbent might just put all the life events together. So you might see baptisms, marriages and burials for 1 year all in one book, which is just chaos, in my opinion. So this change in 1754, it now makes this easier for us to read these documents as well. I don't know if any of you have gone into our browse feature for any of our parish records and flipped through. I quite like doing that, just reading who else was married or baptized around the same time as my ancestors. Good way to find cousins, let me tell you, if you don't already know, which I'm sure many of you already do know that. So the best part, I think, of these parish records is that they just contain so much more than a civil record would, especially when 1837 comes around. I love parish records. I really like them. So something else to be aware of that Steve wanted me to mention was that for a long time, these registers were held in the church itself and they were locked in a parish chest to prevent theft, but it didn't always prevent against things like fire damage or flood damage, which is why, of course, some just haven't survived, in addition to the fact that many were originally on paper as well. And from about 1598, I think, the parish has sent copies of the year's records to the bishop, again, to help combat the fact that, you know, parish records could go missing or they could be damaged. And these are known as bishop's transcripts. And a little bit more on the history. From the early 20th century, churches began handling the completed registers to a county record office. And then that was often the diocese record office as well. So while I'm quickly finishing up the history tour, I am going to come to your questions, I promise. In the 1950s, parish registered were microfilmed. This was to better preserve them, which is fantastic for us because nowadays we have more available to us. And many of the images of parish registers on Findmypast have been scanned from existing microfilm. So the way this works, in case you're not aware, the master reel would be loaded onto a special machine, it would be calibrated, the test images would be taken, and then the reel feeds through the scanner, and then the images are created. So we can see them from the comfort of our own home, which is great. Unfortunately, with the microfilming, this does reproduce grayscale images. So you do lose a bit of the quality there. And mostly today, parish registers are bought online via scanning. And this is far, far superior. It's better in quality. You get them in color as well. And although it's really time consuming and it's a painstaking task for the scanning team, it is so worth the effort, as I'm sure many of you will agree with me on that. So you'll see that throughout this little whistle stop tour, you'll see that parish records in the past 500 years or so have come on quite a journey. They began as paper or parchment, little scribbles, to organized books. And now they've been digitized, they've been indexed, they're searchable. And a family historian like yourself can just do hopefully a quick search on a family history website like ours and find your ancestors. And I know it's very often not quite as easy as that, but hopefully the fact that they've been bought online does make it much easier for you than having to go, for example, to a county record office or go to a church directly, for example. And you can just go back in history. Fantastic. So the last thing I wanted to say as well, although the history lesson was important, and can you tell that I have two history degrees and Steve's obviously an expert and that he helped me with this. I did just want to say that we have a number of parish records online which are exclusive to us, to Findmypast. And I'm not gonna go into detail about this now. I'm just gonna pop a quick link in the comments for you. And this just details the ones that are exclusive to us. And this collection just keeps on growing as well. And I shouldn't forget either, we've also got non-conformist records. So if your ancestors weren't Church of England or Church of Wales, Church of Scotland, we've also got Catholic records as well. We've got them for Ireland, Scotland, we've got some for the USA, got some for England as well. And we're doing our best to bring more online for you all the time. So before we get cracking with the pre-submitted questions, let's have a quick look at the comments and see what you guys are chatting about in here. Let's have a look. Julie says she's loved browsing through the Devon Parish registers. I love looking at the handwriting. I don't know. I don't know about you guys. I just really love old handwriting, photographs, all of that. I love it. Trish has been asking some questions here. Karen as well. Andrew says, greetings from the UK. Do you have to pay a fee to find your ancestors on Findmypast? Yeah, I mean, we offer a 14-day free trial, Andrew, which you're welcome to try. You can start to build a tree for free, but then you could choose a subscription later on if you wanted to carry on. So hopefully that has helped you there. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll have a quick look at the pre-submitted questions. Let's go into there because Steve has really kindly answered some of these that you guys got in a couple of days in advance. So the first question we've got is from Brian, and he asked on Facebook, what is the status on the NYC Roman Catholic Baptism Project? Because we do have a fantastic collection of Catholic records for over in the States, and it's growing. So the status on that is that the Archdiocese of New York Scanning Project is it's a long-term project, and it is still in progress. So we're about 25% through scanning the registers, but digitization has been temporarily suspended due to the current situation, and we're going to be resuming scanning as soon as conditions allow. In the meantime, watch out for updates to the current collection. For example, we're going to be adding more records from 1919 very soon. So yeah, I mean, it just comes back to the fact that we are adding more when we can. But obviously the current situation isn't helping that. But if you do have ancestors over in the US, especially if they're Catholic or they moved out there, do check out those records. They're absolutely fantastic. And a lot of them come with original images as well. So do have a look at those. So thank you for your question, Brian. So Barbara has asked, my four times great-grandparents had seven children during a similar time period. They were all baptized on the same day. The eldest one was nine and the youngest was one. I would have never found them, if I hadn't written to the church archivist and he sent me pages of information about the family. I was looking for my grandfather's baptism, who was never baptized. So Steve's response to this is that we've come across this situation quite frequently. We reckon many baptism registers have at least one example where a batch of children of a marriage, maybe two or three or more, were baptized on the same day in a kind of block booking. It's just a mass baptism. It's hard to know what happened in those circumstances, and each case will of course be different and personal and unique. But Steve just wanted to maybe to list a couple of reasons for why this might have happened. So a change of incumbent at the church may be one possible reason. Maybe the family didn't like the previous one, dating back to a dispute or for whatever reason. So they baptized their children when he was replaced. The second one, which is the one that springs to my mind quite often, is the parents maybe couldn't afford the baptism fees per child. So I think the fees varied at 1 shilling 6 pence, something like that. So they baptized their children all at once when they became more settled and maybe a little bit more well off, so they could actually afford to do it at that point. Another reason might be that the family previously subscribed to a different denomination. So for example, they might have been Baptist or Congregationalist or Independent, but then they join and baptize their children into the established Anglican Church. So that's a possibility as well. Another couple of reasons that Steve's kindly provided, a family of no faith or mistrustful of authority or of official record keeping perhaps might eventually baptize their children later for practical reasons. Being baptized into the Anglican Church might confer certain personal or material advantages to do with relief or the equivalent of what we might now call welfare benefits, or perhaps even facilitating a wedding later on. So that's possible as well. And the last reason is maybe the family just never got round to it and something else could have come up. They could have been really, really busy. They could have had really, really labor intensive jobs, and months turned into years. And, you know, there was nobody maybe going, oh, you must now baptize your children. Maybe eventually they just went to, they knocked on the church door and said, can we baptize our 7 children, please? who knows? Several reasons for that, I think. So thank you for your question there, Barbara. Now let's have a look at the next one. So Michael on Facebook asked, my 4 times great grandparents had 9 children between about 1795 and 1820. 6 in France, Sussex, and the final 3 in Edenbridge in Kent. However, I've found absolutely no trace of them in any baptism records anywhere. Would it simply be a case of them not baptizing their children? So some of the above might apply to this, but Steve has also mentioned that the first thing to do, if you haven't already, would be to see if there are any surviving non-conformist birth or baptism registers for that date in that area. You should do this even if you see no evidence of them being dissidents from the Protestant religion in the family. Some families were adherents to a non-Anglican chapel for 10 or 20 years and then would return to the Church of England. That did happen. There is a history of non-conformism in Kent. There would have been a Wesleyan Methodist circus covering both Frant and also Edenbridge. And Baptists and Independents were also strong in this area as well, and they had places of worship in Edenbridge too. Steve suggests try searching a collection of these records. I do have a link here for you, Michael. Let me just scroll down and pop it in the comments for you. Have a look at these non-conformist births and baptisms if you haven't already. As I said, I've just popped that in the comments for you. Another place to try would be records held at county record offices. However, if it is, as you say, it is inevitable that not all families care to baptize their children, of course. Those living sort of more marginally in society or who live closer to poverty or suspicious of authority, as we've already mentioned, or not religious, anti-church, had a dispute with the parish priest, as we've already said, didn't want to pay baptism fees. That all of the reasons above may be why the children were not baptized. I appreciate it's frustrating when you can't find them. But just things to bear in mind, and hopefully you can find other records to cross-reference into as well. So thank you for your question, Michael. It's a really good one. We've had the 2 questions that have come in next are quite similar, so I'm going to answer them both together. So both Ralph and Sheila, they have asked, why do we on Findmypast have parish records for some counties and parishes but not for others? And similarly, why are some parish records available on Findmypast and not others, etc.? So the answer to this one is that we publish parish records from 2 main sources. The first is by direct arrangement with the record office holding the parish registers, usually but not always the county archive. And if we enter into a publishing arrangement with them, we can digitize, index and publish their parish registers, and that's how they are brought to you. Now, the second way is via a relationship with the Federation of Family History Societies. And this is a coordinating or umbrella body representing a lot of different local family history societies and groups across the country. And many of these societies have been actively indexing these records for decades. The work they've done is staggering and it's so impressive. So our arrangement with them means that a large number of these records then get published on Findmypast. And if you see any without images on Findmypast, these records in most cases will be licensed under our agreement with the Family History Societies. The records that you see with images usually are licensed by us from the record office because that has rights over the original archival material. And Just to say as well, we do actively look for new parish register material from counties we don't have yet or parishes we don't have yet. In the meantime, if you see comparatively few records for a particular county, this will be because we don't have an agreement with that county archive yet or substantial enough material from the Federation of Family History Societies yet. But as I keep saying, we do add more records all the time. So do keep checking back. As I said, every Friday we add more records. So come back and see what we've added. Yeah, fantastic. So thank you, Sheila and Ralph, for your very similar question there. We've also had a question from Fiona, and she asks, is there a central point for parish registers, or do you have to contact each parish? If there is, does this include Ireland, both north and south? So in England and Wales, completed parish registered these days are usually deposited at the appropriate archive, which is often the county record office, as we've already said, but this could be the record office of a city or of a borough. And when we have a publishing arrangement with a record office, this will usually publish all the Anglican parish registers held by them, subject to a modern cutoff because of privacy. For example, this is 100 years for baptism, so we won't have any baptisms pre 1920, post 1920. It's getting to the end of the week and end of the day. Sometimes for one or two parishes, they will decide to opt out of the project or of a digitization project for reasons of their own, and you know, for reasons we must respect as well. So this means if they opt out of having their registers digitized, we must respect that decision and we're unable to publish their parish registers. This is the decision of the current incumbent of that particular parish, and that sometimes changes over time as well. But it is important to note that one incumbent might say, yes, go ahead and digitize our records, and the next one might say, no, we want them taken offline. So just please do bear that in mind. We do have to respect their wishes. And Steve wants to mention as well that the situation in Ireland, so this is the second part of Fiona's question, it's quite complex, and partly because of the North and Republic divide, they're different jurisdictions. So this means inevitably things are different. And beyond that, there are differences by denomination. So for example, in Northern Ireland, many original parish registers for the established church, the Church of Ireland, these are deposited at the Public Record Office of Northern Ireland in Belfast, whereas in the Republic of Ireland, they're held at the Representative Church Body Library in Dublin. That was a really long sentence. At the decentralized end of the scale, many Roman Catholic original registers are still held at parish level in the Republic of Ireland, rather than being centralized at the National Archives of Ireland. Although they do have some microfilm copies, which is good, always good for us. But then there are other denominations as well, so it's Methodist, Presbyterian, and Quaker, and then the picture becomes even more complicated. However, if you are a researcher with Irish interests, many of your troubles should be eased because a great many registers from across Ireland are available on Findmypast, which is great. Yay! Yay for Ireland. Brilliant. Okay. I think we've got one more pre-submitted question, and we'll do that, and then we'll have a quick look into the comments, and then we'll do some live questions. Yay. Okay. So the last pre-submitted question we've got is from Gail. So she says she can't find a baptism for Charles Schofield, who was born around 1822 and was married in St Michael and All Angels in Thornhill, West Yorkshire. Can you help? Been looking for years. Isn't this just a pain, Gail, when you have this one record that you've been looking for absolutely ages? Hopefully we can help. Now, I had a look at this question. My suggestion, before we go on to Steve's answer, my suggestion would be to go back and have a look at his marriage record and see if it mentions who his father was, or which parish he was from as well. If so, these are key pieces of information that you can use to then go and find the correct Charles Schofield, who was born hopefully in the Yorkshire area. So go back and have a look at that. Now, Steve went on to say that, see if you can find the marriage of his parents, and if you can find the baptisms of his siblings, fantastic. It might be that maybe Charles's was missed, as we've discussed. You know, perhaps he just wasn't baptized. And the place of his parents' marriage might indicate that he was born and baptized there as well. So that might help you narrow down your search. So another thing to look at as well, Gail, is with family Anglican. Could they have been non-conformist, Methodist perhaps? It's worth mentioning as well, because as the majority of baptism registers published online are Anglican, we are, you know, publishing more non-conformist ones as well, especially for so-called dissenters. So I hope that has helped. What we'll do is we'll have a quick read through your comments and then we'll move on to some live questions, which is my favorite part. So I just wanted to say thank you to Alex and to Steve, who've been going through your comments, and hopefully we've got some answers for you. So let's have a quick look, see what you guys are chatting about. Michael's saying thank you for the answers. Please just thank Steve. Steve's the expert here. I'm just his voice today. I don't think I actually sound like Steve. I think Steve sounds a little bit more refined than me. Is that strange to say? We've got people helping each other out. So William's helping out Colleen, saying look for siblings. Yeah, absolutely. If you can't find an ancestor, look for their siblings, look for their cousins, just search around them. I think some of us get it, some of us think that we have to just follow that one line, but if you get stuck at any point, if that ancestor just can't be found, move around them. You know, you might find that you can get further back that way, and that might actually lead you to that missing ancestor in the end. So fantastic. Graham says hi, late in, working at home, almost finished. Good. I hope you'll put your feet up now, Graham. what else have we got here? So Kim says, my granddad, his siblings and parents were all baptized twice. Wow, twice. Separately as Church of England, and then in a job lot together as Catholic when the children were in their teens. I've never heard of that happening. That's brilliant. Oh, great. Okay. Yes. Okay. So what we'll do is, as you are all chatting amongst yourselves and helping each other, which I love, let's go and have a look at some live questions. So Linda says, are there any plans to publish more non-conformist registers and irregular border marriages? Ancestors in the border regions are very difficult to research without them. They are a little bit. So Steve says, hi Linda, we're always on the lookout for more of these types of registers, so we do hope to publish more later this year. Oh, teaser there. So keep an eye open, Linda. Check your Friday emails. If you're not opted in, go into your Findmypast account, go to your account settings, and if you're not already opted into newsletters, you can opt into them there. If you would prefer not to receive them, I always put an update on every Friday on Facebook as to what we've shared that week. It also goes on to Twitter as well, so you can always check there. So Trish says, I've not been able to find details of my late father-in-law's death. He died in November 2007. I've managed to find another death at the same parish, but a few years later. Any help would be appreciated. And Steve has asked here for you, Trish, where did he pass away? Is it his death or actually his burial record that you're looking for? Because obviously burial records, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Steve, but the cutoff I think is 70 years. So we won't have any burial records that recent, but what you could do is you could go and maybe speak to the church directly and they may be able to help you. And we've got Julie saying, for baptisms and burials, do we have any idea of an average time after a birth or death respectively that happened? So Steve's answer for this, thank you Steve, in England during, for example, the 19th century, the average period of time between birth and baptism seems to have been about 4 weeks. However, you sometimes see same day baptisms. For example, if the newborn baby was quite sickly and perhaps likely to pass away quite soon, the baptism would happen sooner because there was a fear that the child would pass away unbaptized, which is quite sad. Burial would have taken place within a few days after death, unless there was a need for an inquest and a coroner's report. Perhaps there was a suspicious death, but in most practices, a few days after death. So I hope that's been helpful for you. So we've got Karen. Karen's got a question here. Was there a penalty for not being baptized around 1812 in Kennington in Surrey because you can't find your three times great grandfather? Again, it's so frustrating when you can't find this one record. I really, really sympathize with you, Karen. So Steve says that there were not penalties as far as we're aware for the non-baptism of a child. Membership of the parish church wasn't mandatory. And in some areas, a significant proportion of the local population wouldn't even have been parishioners. It's also important to mention that in some areas there was a lively tradition of non-conformism, and I would believe that for Kennington that this was one such area. So you should consider the various free churches, so Baptists and Independents, etc. So thank you for your question, Karen. Hopefully that will help. Let's have another scroll through these questions here. So Stephen says, can you tell me what a conditional baptism is? So Steve's answer for Stephen is one example is at conversion. So for example, if a person converts to Catholicism, the Catholic Church may not have confidence that the individual's previous baptism into a different confession would meet its own requirements. So then they're baptized again. So that's Steve's answer for a conditional baptism. And I think we're getting towards the end of the live questions, which is good. Now, Colleen, I can see a question's come in from you, and I can see that I've got an answer coming in from Steve. I'm just going to let Steve finish up that reply very quickly. And we'll have another flick through your comments, see what you guys are chatting about, and helping each other out again, which I love seeing that. So we're about 40 minutes in, which is good for me. Normally I cut off at about the 35 minute mark, because I, unlike Miko and Alex, I really struggle to talk for a full hour. So yes, let's have a look. Enid, wish you had a full quantity of parish records for the proper north of England, Northumberland and Cumberland. Yeah, unfortunately, Enid, this is just up to them whether we're allowed to have their records or not. So hopefully they'll change their minds in the future and we can publish some more. Excuse me, I need a drink after all this talking. I never talk this much. That's a lie. I talk a lot. Kim says, most of my ancestors couldn't decide on their names or age, so their religion changing came as no surprise. Oh, what is it my mother always says? I wonder if she's watching. She said she was going to tune in. I used to be indecisive, but now I'm not so sure. I love that saying. Oh, hopefully, if she is watching, she'll have laughed at that. Valerie says, hello from Kingston, Ontario, Canada. Just here learning. Thank you. You're more than welcome, Valerie. That's what we hope to do. We hope to impart a little bit of knowledge while having a little bit of fun with this at the same time. Brilliant. Rosie helping out Trish as well. Laurie, so if I understand you correctly, you may have published records online that can be pulled later, depending on who the incumbent is. Yes, it doesn't happen very often, Laurie. It does happen from time to time. It's a shame, it honestly is, but we do just have to respect the decision of the parish if they decide to do that. Maureen's saying she's enjoying the family tree talks. Good. Maybe we should do more on actually another one on building trees as well. Would anybody be interested in a session on that in the future? Maybe pop that in the comments if you are, because as I said earlier, these sessions are for you, and although we've got a good schedule over the next month or so, it's all subject to change. So if you want to see something, if you want a session on something in particular, I had a request for Northern Ireland family history earlier this week. So we'll hopefully do something on that. So if you do want to see something, you do want to be involved in a particular discussion, pop it in the comments. I don't know if I'm pointing in the right direction for where you're looking, but I'm pointing in the right direction for me in any case. Okay, so I think Steve has finished answering Colleen's question, so I can get to that now. Thank you, Steve. So Colleen says, what would be the easiest way to find information on someone with a very common Christian name and surname without a birth date and only a guess of where they're from? And she says, thanks in advance. You're welcome. So Steve says, unfortunately, it sounds like there would be no easy way for this. The usual advice is to start from scratch. working back systematically and methodically from what you know about the person. It might be worth making a little list of what you absolutely know for certain and then mark anything that is a guess. Establish those key facts in their life, and hopefully that'll help you narrow down the date and the place. But of course, so much depends on the date and the place concerned. The advice for whether they were born in Scotland and England would differ, for example, as with the advice whether you're looking for somebody born in 1700 or 1900. What remains the same is to just work back from what is definitely known at this point. I appreciate it's hard when you have somebody with a very common name. Although I'm lucky with a name like Overthrow, I've also got Joneses, Davies and Smiths in my family tree. So I completely understand your pain, Colleen. So I think that's all the live questions. If you do have any more, get them in quick. We'll look at something else very quickly. If you do want any more questions answered, get those in and we can have a look at those before we finish up. So the last thing I wanted to really embark, I wanted to share a little bit more knowledge, I suppose, mainly from my own experience of searching parish registers. I've got some tips for you. So I've got five of my own tips for searching them. So first of all, my first tip is to search all of them. So cross county. This is a particularly good idea if your ancestors might have moved around. I remember that towns moved counties over time. So just from personal experience, my Davies family from Abergele in North Wales, I lost them from the records at one point. I can't remember exactly what year it was that I lost them, but I thought, that's it, I've hit a brick wall, I can't go any further, don't know where they've gone. So this was at the time, Abergele was in Denbighshire. And then I realised that at one point, Abergele was actually in Carnarvonshire. So I was searching in the Denbighshire parish registers, widened the search, and I found them in Carnarvonshire. And then I looked up and then realised that they had actually moved. They hadn't moved. Abergele had moved across the county border from Carnarvonshire into Denbighshire. So that's just something to be aware of as well. So if you're not sure, or you've got a town that's going to be on a border and might have moved over time, broaden out your search. But if you do want to search a particular county, you can use our A to Z and you can type in a county there. For example, if you want to search the Denbighshire marriages. That's tip number one. Tip number two is sort of leads on from tip number one. Don't assume your ancestors stayed in the same place. They may have moved around for work. So you can add in, when you search for them, don't add your tiny little village, don't add the town if you can help it. Add in the county. This just helps if they moved around. I think he's my three times great grandfather, Hugh Jones. He was born in 1816 in Merionethshire. But by the 1840s or 50s, he's in Wrexham for mining work. And I know it's definitely him because I've managed to pinpoint him in the census at one point saying he's born in Merionethshire and then finding his baptism there. So he would have moved. So just bear that in mind. Another thing is, when searching parish registers, make sure you tick those name variants, especially when searching further back in time, because spelling changed so much. So my family name, Overthrow, at one point going back into the 16 and 1700s, it had a random E on the end. And at some point that was dropped and hasn't been seen since, which is probably best. It just looks a bit bizarre, I think. Again, another relative of mine, I think he was my great grandfather. He was born Dob, but later added an S on to make it Dobbs. No idea why. Our ancestors did things that we sometimes can't comprehend. So bear that in mind when you're searching. Use those name variants. And of course, people went by nicknames as well. So somebody might have been born an Elizabeth, but might have been known as Lizzie or Liz or Eliza when they married. So think about that as well. What's my next tip? If you can't find ancestors in the traditional parish registers, as we've already said, go and look in the non-conformist and the Catholic records. not everybody was Church of England, remember. My Nana's family came over from what is now Northern Ireland, and they were Catholic. So I've not been able to find those in traditional parish registers. They've been in the Catholic records. So make sure to check those. And my last tip is, as I keep saying, but it is so, so important, keep checking back each week to see what you've added. If you have hit a brick wall, if you've hit a stop in your research, come back and check and see what we've added on a Friday. Maybe we've added something for a county that you're interested in, or we've added some new military records or something like that. Just come back and have a look. It might help you solve a mystery, it might help you knock down a brick wall, and it might even help you get back another generation on your family tree. So, fantastic. I'm just going to double check and see if there are any more live questions. One has come in from Julie, but I'll give Steve a minute to answer that. So we'll just have another quick look in the comments and see what you guys are asking about here. Let's have a look. Sorry, I'm just scrolling. There have been so many comments. Thank you so much for engaging. It's lovely to see, as I said at the beginning, you guys all chatting to each other. Anya says, I love your mug. You just need some red dragons. Yeah, I absolutely adore this mug. This is my daffodil mug. bought specially for me for my birthday by my partner. Because as I say in all of these live broadcasts, I am Welsh and I'm very proudly Welsh. Oh, I'm losing my voice now. I don't think we'll quite make it to the hour, I'm afraid. Kim, it's our family motto. Oh, I love that. Debbie, would be interesting in building family trees. You should add, if you've not done it, if any of you haven't done a family tree yet, give it a go. Even if you want to just draw what you know on paper about your family, draw that out. It's a great activity to do with children as well. So if you've got children, get them involved. You could maybe give their grandparents a quick call or a video chat, and you can ask them questions. We've also got a free downloadable and printable template that you can find on our blog. You can use that, but we've also got our free online tree builder as well, so you can start adding people in for free. And the only time we'd start asking you to pay for a subscription, for example, or to take the free trial, is if you want to look at the records themselves, so like the records we've been talking about today. We do have some records that are free on Findmypast, which is nice, including, believe it or not, the Irish Catholic records. So if you do have Irish ancestors and they were Catholic, you can look at those for free. Winner. Okay, Stephen has a quick question about adoption records for 1930 in South Wales. So these won't be public, I'm afraid. I know it's not very recent, being 1930, but you might need to contact the General Register Office or the government for that, I'm afraid. I don't think we're allowed to make adoption records public because they're quite sensitive documents. So yes, Maureen, I said Henry III. Did I say Henry III? If I said Henry III, my apologies, I did mean Henry VIII. I did do the Tudors at A-level, I promise you. Jackie, earlier I had help from one of your staff on how to remove people who are duplicated on my tree, from which I'm most grateful. That's really good, Jackie. Thank you for saying that. We have an incredible support team. Though they may be small, they are mighty, and their knowledge is brilliant, and they're all very friendly. I know them all very well. So if you do have any problems with your tree, with your account, they are the people to go and talk to, is our amazing support team. Okay. Karina, Norwegian. Hello, Karina. Thanks for joining us. We are coming towards the end now. So what we'll do is I don't think Steve's managed to get to Julie's question, I'm afraid. I'm sorry about that. Hopefully he can go into the comments and he can answer it for you. So I think what we'll do is we'll wrap up. I want to thank everybody who's joined today, because whether you've got a busy schedule, whether you join in here just to maybe pass the time and learn something new, I appreciate it. And I hope that you've learned something new. It's lovely to see you all here and helping each other out. And I did just want to point out as well before we finish, in a change to our schedule for tomorrow, Alex is taking a well-deserved break. So unfortunately, you won't get to see him beardless until next week. I'm sorry to say that. Maybe we can finally convince him to play a song as well for us on his guitar. So in Alex's place tomorrow, Niall will be stepping into Alex's shoes and he is going to host Friday's Live tomorrow. And it's also VE Day tomorrow as well. So I hope you'll be celebrating with bunting, with cake, and whatever you have around the house, I suppose. We're also going to be announcing something really, really exciting tomorrow. So keep your eyes peeled in the morning. I will be sharing the details. And you'll probably get it in your Friday email as well if you're opted into those. As always, be sure to check out the lovely folk in the Find My Past forum for further genealogy goodness, for help with handwriting, with photos, with general research questions, etc. I'm going to be back here on Tuesday with my guided tour of Find My Past's website, which I'm really excited for, actually. So if you're a beginner, make sure to check back and I'm going to show you where you can find everything, how everything works, how to use the tree and things like that. We'll do some test searches as well, so hopefully that'll be useful for you. And hey, even if you're not a beginner, tune in anyway if you want to, and you might learn something new anyway. So we'll just we'll say goodbye. Anya, I might put up my Welsh flag tomorrow. You should. I wish I had a Welsh flag here. You know, I think the only thing I've got is I've got an old Welsh rugby jersey. But it doesn't even have sort of a Welsh dragon or anything on. It's just sort of red. Maybe I'll wear that when I do my session on Tuesday. Maybe not. So thank you to Ellen for joining. Thanks to William. Thanks to Laurie. Thanks to Rosie. Thanks to Kim, Patricia, Linda. Just thank you to everybody, really. I hope you have a lovely evening. Go put your feet up and relax. And I will catch you next time. Take care. Bye-bye.